In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for being here with us, for being our good shepherd. Thank you for this experience you've given us already. Help us to renew it, to face all the challenges of our lives with this awareness that you are a real good shepherd. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Okay. Holy Spirit, amen. I suppose it's recording me only, the speaker. Okay. So today or tonight we have this psalm, which is maybe the most popular psalm of the whole collection of the Psaltir of the 150 psalms, and it's probably the most beautiful too. Very poetic and very deep in his in its meaning. So there are many versions. We've just heard one in the song. There are many translations. I mean, the original is only one for sure in Hebrew. I had a look a little bit at the original Hebrew text. Anyway, I took the translation of the Jerusalem Bible. So I will read it little by little, because it's each word, each verse can tell us so much. But first of all, I would like also to make a little bit of context. I suppose that Dan and Steve told you about the author of the Psalms, like according to the tradition, it's David, the King David. We don't know exactly now. Many Bible scholars doubt that, but anyway, we can think that others maybe wrote, other disciples of David or other people of the time of David, or later wrote down some of these psalms. But anyway, as they are poetical texts, they are very, very, very deep, and they weren't just changed over and over again. Some bits are really the original ones, because they express the prayer, especially the prayer of the author. So this psalm in particular could be written by David in a situation of trial. One of the hypotheses is that it was written when David was betrayed by his own son, Absalom. Maybe you remember a little bit the story, how David had an affair with a woman who wasn't his wife at the beginning. Then they married, but anyway, that like had consequences. And so one of his sons, Absalom, when he was adult, wanted to basically to steal the kingdom from David. And so that was a big trial for the king and for a father to be betrayed by his own son. And that is one of the theories when the psalm was written, which context. So anyway, it could have been another trial, but it's quite impressive, quite striking to see which faith David shows, even though he was so tested in such a tough way by life or by God. And so we can see how David actually had passed through many trials, especially by his own failure as a king, by his own sin, by the death of his first son, actually. So David had this experience, how God never betrayed him, even though his son maybe was betraying him in that moment. But David had like accumulated quite a few experiences of God's faithfulness until that moment. And so he can write such beautiful words about God as his shepherd. Also, we know that David himself was a shepherd when he was a young boy. So he must have known quite a bit about sheep and farms and all that. But it's not only David. Throughout the Bible, we see this image of God as a shepherd. And Jesus also takes it again in the gospel in a few passages. So yeah, maybe Stephen then could tell you more about sheep and shepherds and farms. I haven't got much experience in this field. One of my grandfathers was a shepherd actually in Sardinia. There are many shepherds and sheep until now. Anyway, we can start with the first words. The Lord is my shepherd. So we can think a little bit about being a sheep. What I read is that sheep is usually in danger of starvation if it's not fed properly, and also it's in danger of enemies, of attacks of other animals. So the shepherd must be there to take care of the sheep and to feed it properly. So this is what also God does with us many, many times. He protects us from dangers. So many dangers we have in our life, in our spiritual life too. And he feeds us properly. He wants us to grow, to be good and healthy sheep. So we can think a little bit about this image of the sheep, of the shepherd. And also a sheep is lost when it doesn't have, when it's by itself, as also Jesus talks about in the parable of the lost sheep. So we need a flock, we need a community. Otherwise we are lost. I'm experiencing that quite a bit lately. And we are talking about that with the youth, how much we need a community. Because if we try to do everything by ourselves, and to solve our problems by ourselves, we get lost, we get astray. So we need a shepherd and we need a flock. But the shepherd, the good shepherd, is the one who leads the community. And this is Jesus, as we know. And we can think about so many times when God rescued us, when God protected us, when God fed us. I think all of us have experiences of this kind. And Jesus is always there looking for us as he looks for the lost sheep in the gospel. He's so patient and merciful towards us. And he takes care of us in everything. I think I shared with someone that I'm processing my permanent visa, and I had a few adventures with that because they lost my documents in the Australia Post. Yeah, a few adventures, but now I lodged all the documents, and it was a miracle because it was very, very difficult for different reasons. It's a simple example, but it's my like most recent example about how God takes care of me, and we don't have to worry. We worry about many things. We forget about the past experience of his care, but he's always there taking care of us. And then the following words are, I lack nothing. And it's important to renew this experience too, because we we all have to face sooner or later are deep void we have in our hearts, and many times we try to fill it with other things or with other people, and we don't really believe that if I have God, I lack nothing. So God is enough, as Saint Teresa of Avila said. So we should experience more and more how when we are in God's presence, when we are in communion with Him, when we deep believe in His love, we are really at peace. We can notice if we believe, if we have this experience, when we lose everything we relied on before, and so we feel lost. Whereas if God is the first in our lives, we will be able to continue even though when we lose everything else. So it's important to in our prayer, for example, to be still, to really just be with God, not need to do other things. It's difficult sometimes to just be with God and let Him fill our voids. Then the psalm continues with these words, my translation: in grassy meadows he lets me lie. This is interesting too. We can imagine sheep or other animals or on a green field of grass. They eat and they usually have a siesta, no? They say in Spanish. And so God wants us to rest. It's connected a little bit with what I said before. We think that we will have a full life when we have a life full of activities, full of things, full of material achievements, of titles, I don't know. And we get tired of trying to achieve all that. We get tired of doing so many things, of working from morning to night. God wants us to rest deep in our hearts. We have to do things. It's normal. We have to work. We have to take care of our families. We have to fulfill the different missions or tasks the Lord entrusts to us. But we must have this constant inner rest, even by doing. While we are doing many other things, God wants us to put our trust in Him, wants us to rely on Him and not on ourselves. And He wants us to let Him guide us to these green fields or to these grassy meadows. But again, it's not always so easy, because we oftentimes think that God wants us to prove to Him that we are good in this, in that, and also in front of other people, we often have this tension of wanting to prove that we are good, we are at something at least, and so we can live in this constant tension instead of living under God's sight, who loves us unconditionally. And even worse, we can think that God wants us to suffer, and we struggle to just stop and rest like God wants us to do. And then it continues: by tranquil streams He leads me. So God leads us to good waters, not to bad waters, not to bitter waters or poisonous waters. He leads us to good waters. The sheep, I think in my background it's shown as well, go to a good lake because they need to drink, and to drink good water, to drink, to be, yet to continue their journey. So it's so important to believe that God is leading our lives to tranquil streams, to good waters, not to bad waters, not to a disaster. Sometimes we think that God is leading us to the abyss or something. And yeah, we think the world is going towards an abyss. But God, if we let him guide us, he will always offer us, again, green pastures and tranquil waters. But we have to listen to his voice deep in our hearts. So it's not only a passive thing. God needs our yes and needs our collaboration. Otherwise, we can't go out of the challenges or difficulties of our lives, which are there as well. So we need to let God guide us. Otherwise, he can't lead us to good waters. And then he continues. It continues, Psalm, to restore my spirit. And I think we all have had this experience. Sometimes maybe we are very busy with many things, so we are wearied with problems. And so we need to go to Jesus, to go to prayer, to let him restore our spirit. I experienced that many times, especially in the Eucharist. Sometimes when I was tired, even physically, the Eucharist restored me. I felt a new strength, a new light, a new peace. We need this constant restoration, which only God can give us, only our good shepherd. And then it continues, he guides me in paths of saving justice, as befits his name. And this is very important too. According to other translations, it's written, he guides me in paths of righteousness. So God knows that the good, the green pastures, the green fields are holiness in life. So the best, like, goal of our lives is to become righteous, to become holy. So all our other goals, all our achievements, again, are very secondary, not so relevant as our holiness. And God wants that for us because he knows that this is the greatest fulfillment we can achieve in life and the greatest also plan we can offer others. We can offer our families, our friends, many things, many secondary things, but the best thing we can offer them is really to help them to live a righteous life, to live a holy life, to follow the example of Jesus. This is the where God is. God wants to lead each one of us as befits his name or for the sake of his name. And that means that the greatest glory for God, there was a Holy Father, Saint Irenaeus from the second century. He said, the glory of God is man fully alive. So God doesn't want glory from himself. His glory is really to see us alive, to see us holy, to see us happy, to see us growing in our path of life. This is what God deeply wants for us. And then the following verse is very powerful too. Even were I to walk in a ravine as dark as death, I should fear no danger, for you are at my side. And I think all of us experienced moments like that. We can imagine also this when we pass through a valley of darkness, when, a place which is completely dark and frightening, where we lose our control, where we don't know where we are going, where we don't see any way out. I think this pandemic can talk to us about that, or many other experiences where it seems that everything is dark and deadly. So David was experiencing something like that, or had experienced before. Nevertheless, he also cries, I should fear no danger, for you are at my side. So we can lose all certainties in life. We can lose all, everything, but we will never lose this certainty deep in our hearts, even when we don't feel it, even when we are still trembling. We can believe, you are at my side, Lord. You are there. You will never abandon me as you has never abandoned me. And then also David explains why your staff and your crook are there to soothe me. And this image is also interesting. The staff is like a tool to help us, to help the shepherd to walk. And the crook or the rod is like an instrument to defend, to fight. So this is what God does with us. So he walks in front of us. He leads us towards green pastures, but he also defends us from all evil, because there are many evils, unfortunately, in a spiritual life, in the world. But we are not alone. Our good shepherd, God, is there in front of us with these two tools, and so we can be comforted, we can be at peace. Again, even if, humanly speaking, we can fear, we can feel very weak as the sheep, very lost, but we are not lost because God is with us, because we want him to guide our lives. And then it says, you prepare a table for me under the eyes of my enemies. And I suppose that Ben and Steve explained to you how in the Psalms especially, there are lots of references to enemies. And sometimes the psalmist can be very, it can sound quite aggressive to us when he talks about the enemies. But it's an image of the spiritual battle. We know that Jesus doesn't want us to be aggressive towards our enemies. On the contrary, he wants us to love them. But that is not the case for our spiritual life, because we all have different temptations. In the world also we see big things. So we have to hate that. We have to struggle to fight against that with all our determination, with God's help. And God assures us here a triumph. So it's like this image of preparing a table in front of the enemies. So we can win over all our temptations, or on all our spiritual enemies, we can heal our spiritual wounds. But again, with God. And so we can recall, if you want, also moments when God is triumphing in our lives, and when we won a spiritual battle, it was God there. I told many times. I always remember in my at the beginning of my vocation, when I just joined the community, I had a deep moment of crisis. I wanted to throw in the towel and to leave everything. But God, also Mother Mary, really helped me to say yes once again to their plans for me. It was their help, for sure. It was my yes as well. So our collaboration is indispensable. But in the end, I really felt this triumph against evil, like Mary when she stoops on the serpent. So we can experience that too if we persevere and if we let God guide us. And connected to that, the psalmist adds, "You anoint my head with oil, my cup brims over." And the oil was typically used in that time for kings or for some special ceremony. So it's again a sign of triumph on the enemies. And we can recall moments of joy that God gave us. I can imagine your wedding. Many of you are married. I just celebrated a wedding anniversary of 50 years. It was very, very nice. I remember my ordination when I was ordained almost 18 years ago. Also, it was a moment of great joy from the Lord, of triumph, of His grace. We can remember these moments like this or other moments when God has been powerful in our lives. And the last verses are very important too. Again, there are many translations. I've got this one: kindness and faithful love, or we can see also goodness and mercy, for pursue me every day of my life. So all we need, again, is to experience God's mercy and God's goodness in our lives. We don't need anything else. And here, the author of the psalm, David or whoever, guarantees us that it's possible to experience that every day here on earth, already, not only in heaven. It's connected to heaven. These two last verses are a door, a window towards heaven. But it's in the original Hebrew, it talks about all days of my life. So we can experience God's goodness, God's mercy. We can believe in that even when we pass through struggles every day of our lives, even the darkest days of our lives. God's goodness, God's mercy are there. And then the last words are, "I make my home in the house of David for all time to come," or "for all eternity," also in the original Hebrew it's written. So here David or whoever opens a window towards eternity. So it's true that in our lives there are situations that cannot be fixed as we would like to, and so we will experience this, we will understand God as our good shepherd in a full way only in heaven, because there are situations of our lives we still don't understand. So it's a window towards eternal life, but we can start believing in our good shepherd's care. Anyway, it's also a symbol of Jesus' death and resurrection. These last two verses can be connected to Jesus' passion and triumph at the same time. We have to pass through death, through the valley of darkness, to experience the light again. But it's possible to believe in the resurrection, in the and especially in God as our good shepherd. I remember also a couple of friends I had in Italy of my youth. We used to go out together, and they had two kids. And a few years ago, the daughter, they have two kids. The daughter got cancer, leukemia, and she passed away when she was only 13 years old. So it was a big trauma. But the mother, can you imagine, was very thankful for her daughter, because her daughter was a saint, really. She's quite famous in my hometown in Pavia, because she was very, very religious. She wanted communion every day when she was in hospital. She gave a testimony of faith to everybody, to all the people who went to visit her. So it was a very sad moment, for sure, but it was also the triumph of God's grace, because the example of this girl really impacted my little hometown there in Italy. And her mother, in the end, at the funeral, was very thankful. She expressed her thanksgiving to God for the life of her daughter, even though she had her only 13 years. And surely it's sad when I visit them, when I go to Italy, it's still a wound in their lives, but at the same time, they have this awareness that she was like an angel sent by God, and they're really thankful to God for her mission on earth. Yeah, so it's a challenge sometimes, but we can discover God as our good shepherd in all situations of our lives. And so these are my reflections. This has been my prayer today, but I invite you now to have a personal moment with this psalm. We heard it lots of times. It's a psalm that gave hope and gives hope to millions of people, not only Christians of all confessions, but also Jews. It's a very famous text, used even by people who don't have much faith. So we can now renew this experience in our own life, and we can also pray for the people who need this experience. So put the questions in the chat. Okay, stop recording first. Sorry.